One of France's largest evangelical churches is named after an American icon. It's also a thriving community center.
Any way you look at it, the Martin Luther King Church is a foretaste of heaven. George Thomas traveled to Paris to see firsthand how this church is changing one of Europe's most famous cities.
In a communist, socialist, and conservative suburb of Paris, a song of reconciliation and unity is rising. And with it, a message that's attracting people from diverse backgrounds.
I don't have to build a church. I have to build a place where people will be loved, will be changed by the Holy Spirit and by the power of God.
I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream.
French pastor Yvonne Caluère founded Martin Luther King Church here in Paris's Chrétiel neighborhood, after drawing inspiration from the civil rights leader's message of unconditional love.
Loving people as they are, and don't try to make them look like you are, but just love them and introduce them to a God who will change them.
Every valley shall be exalted.
Like Martin Luther King, Caluère says he too had a dream to create a space where blacks, whites, and people of other racial backgrounds could come together and reflect the diversity of Paris.
When God asked me to ministry, he asked me to be a minister in Paris area. So when I came, I realized that more than 50% of the kids in Paris area have an African dad or mother. So more than 50% of the newborn babies are mixed, and I love it.
Caluère's dream is now a reality.
We have now like 20% all black, 10% all white, 10% Asian, and 60% cannot be defined. Jesus color.
And that message of love shared across racial lines has been a unifying force for positive change.
This is what I think is the most touching and most extraordinary aspect of this church. Everyone is mixed. All cultures are represented.
I've been here since the church first launched, and to see how much it's grown is amazing. The work is enormous, and it's a blessing to many people.
MLK is now one of the country's largest evangelical churches, prompting French newspaper Le Monde to call Yvonne Caluère a rising figure in France's Protestant movement.
MLK, which is about 7 miles southeast of Paris, is rather remarkable for its size. You see, in all of France, there are about 2,500 evangelical churches, and the average church has about 100 people. MLK went from 20, 17 years ago, to over 3,000 people today.
Sur ta confession de foi, je te baptise au nom du Père, du Fils et du Saint-Esprit.
During a recent weekend service, 76 people from different walks of life and racial backgrounds professed faith in Jesus Christ in water baptism.
And we haven't seen so many people coming to Jesus like now. God is moving in France like never.
Evangelicals make up just 2% of the population here, and their numbers are growing. A recent report found evangelicals becoming a majority within the French Protestant movement. Caluère says the pandemic led to even greater numbers as new people flocked to the church's online services.
We already reach more than 30 to 40,000 every week. And when you look at Google Analytics, we see what is very good, that a lot of non-believers are watching.
Because of the growth, Caluère says the church needed a bigger place to meet. So in September 2021, the new Martin Luther King space opened here in the southeastern suburbs of Paris. At a cost of $30 million, a foundation operates it as part church, part community center. And because of its community influence, Pastor Caluere says local government authorities were all too happy to chip in more than $3 million toward the building's fund.
That's why we can have money from the state, the government, the county, etc. They all give to the foundation. The foundation is the owner of the building, and the church rent the building.
Church services are held Saturday and Sunday in the building's 1,000-seat auditorium. The rest of the week, it's open to the community for rent. Companies have held fashion shows, car shows, and music concerts. Members of other religious groups have also held their events here. Caluere sees it as a model for people not typically drawn to a church building, per se, to be introduced to the gospel.
My goal for me is I want Jewish, Muslim, atheist, political, artist, all of them, they all need to be loved by God, to be transformed by the Holy Spirit, and to become a loving of each other like Martin Luther King did.
In spite of its staunchly secular traditions, Pastor Caluere says God is on the move in France and takes heart in what he's doing in churches like MLK.
So now it's really a foretaste of heaven.
George Thomas, CBN News, Paris.
I love it. I love what he said. We're 20% black, 10% white, 10% Asia, and 60% the color of Jesus. A foretaste of heaven. When you read the book of Revelation, you see it. All languages, all tribes, all tongues, everyone coming together, singing as one, a new song to the Lamb.
For many families, paying for groceries is a struggle.
I lost half of my income for a couple of months. It was very hard, trying to make my car payment and trying to keep everything paid by myself as a single mom.
Thanks to Operation Blessing's Hunger Strike Force, there is hope.
We went to Operation Blessing, they loaded my car up, I mean, completely full. And there were so many kind people there. My daughter, I mean, she'll probably never forget it. I want to thank everyone who gave to Operation Blessing. I know I personally was very, very blessed by Operation Blessing.
Reports show over 11 million American children will face hunger this holiday season. Your gift of $20 can help provide over 140 pounds of food and essentials to feed America's hungry children and families and so much more.
Well, Zachary Levi is well known for his roles in Shazam, American Underdog, and The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel. Now he's using his fame as a platform to tell his personal story and to shed light on the issue of mental health. The actor sat down with Ephraim Grant to talk about his childhood trauma, his healing, and how it all led to the role of a lifetime.
Shazam? From superhero.
I don't know where we go from here. I don't know what comes next, but this, we did this.
To Super Bowl champ.
Yeah, man, I know who you are. I'm Kurt.
Zachary Levi lands larger than life acting roles quite regularly.
How would you describe the childhood or the life of Zachary Levi Pugh?
How much time you got? I mean, I think like most kids, in the moment, when I was a kid, it was normal. There wasn't anything, you know, particularly traumatic or that I could point to and say, like, oh, I'm living a traumatized life. You don't realize that until far later in life, hopefully. Mm-hmm. A lot of people don't ever realize that. Looking back on it, I can assure you an incredibly traumatizing childhood. There was just lots and lots of unhealthy, toxic behavior that was going on. Again, I could tell you that there were things that were making me cry on a regular basis or things that I was afraid of on a regular basis. But I didn't necessarily see those as being anything other than, well, I guess this is normal. I guess this is what other kids probably deal with as well, you know? So that would be you know, a snapshot into my life, I suppose.
What do you think childhood for you did to your adulthood?
Young Zach was this, I don't know, little boy kind of just lost in a sea of estrogen between my sisters, my mom, my aunts, my grandma. But fortunately, and this is the grace of God, not just the grace of God, but the plans of God, I figured out very early on in life, probably around 4, was when I was first truly cognizant of the idea that I could make someone laugh intentionally. Before that, every kid makes people laugh accidentally. You don't know why. Around 4, I think I was finally smart enough to go, oh, I can do this thing. I can do X or Y, and that will make somebody laugh. And I also knew, because I think at 4, you're emotionally intelligent enough to know that a laughing, smiling person feels good. And I never, ever wanted to stop doing that. I was immediately called to, addicted to, not realizing also that because I was lost in this world and trying to find identity and worth and value and all that jazz, I was both, you know, fulfilling a calling, I think, in my life, but also figuring out very quickly how to run away from metabolizing my pain, figuring out how to be the clown, be the guy, bring the happy, bring the joy.
You don't have a tape in here, but it's digital.
Being a quick study earned Levi a starring role early and an escape from real life, abuse, a mom with mental struggles, and an absent father.
I was running from pain my whole life. I was running from pain. I'm grateful that I was able to find what I loved to do and what I was good at doing at such a young age, because I think a lot of people don't. Even though that was also something that was, I think, you know, insulating me from doing a lot of the work that I needed to do that eventually led me to having a massive breakdown later on in life.
He shares his story with us and even more in his memoir, Radical Love, Learning to Accept Yourself and Others.
You talk about going from suicidal to superhero and then suicidal again. Take me back to the rock bottom moment. What happened?
I felt like I was failing, ultimately. Like, most of my life, I've felt like a failure. Even though from the outside, it looks like, oh, I'm very much succeeding. But I'm not succeeding on the level that I feel like I'm supposed to or that I was called to.
She's a little artsy.
With music, Broadway, the big and small screens on his resume, he left Hollywood.
With a head full of steam and dreams, I moved out to Austin, and I didn't know anyone out there. And all of a sudden, after 15 years of living in Los Angeles and having community and support structure and all of those things, I was now, Geronimo, let's go. Oh, wait a minute, now I'm alone. Oh, wait a minute, this isn't happening the way that I felt like God was calling me out here to do this. And why aren't the doors opening? Oh my gosh, I have blown up my life. I have now entirely failed my life. There is no coming back from this failure. I would say if suicide is climbing a 10-rung ladder, I was at rung 9. And thankfully, I have family and friends that surrounded me, supported me, were there for me, and just enough for me to get up and go to therapy, this life-saving therapy. But, it was a perfect storm, but it was 37 years of lots and lots and lots and lots of trauma, unhealed trauma. A real testament of how I think, you know, God works and what we ought to prioritize. I was not prioritizing the most important thing, which was to actually invest in myself and to care for myself and love myself, because I didn't understand that. So to go away and do this therapy, finally, and really figure out, oh my gosh, I haven't loved myself my entire life. I've never even understood what that meant. And also, oh, this feeling that I feel inside, that I felt my whole life, that's anxiety? Oh, I'm glad I finally know what anxiety is.
Therapy began his healing, a rebirth of his faith, and the role of a lifetime.
Say my name.
Shazam literally happened while I was still like finishing up my therapy, but only, you know, because God was like, good, now you've done the thing. Now I can give you the blessing. You would have self-destructed had I given you this blessing before you did the work. And that's the work.
So how does it feel sitting here now, knowing I think at one point I'm reading that you felt you lost God and he was gone?
Oh, man. And I was driving around in Austin recently, driving up this road that was kind of near the house that I was staying in when I was having this breakdown, and this Cilantro restaurant where I was having this breakdown. And I was driving by it, and it just all flooded back. I was like, oh, wow. Like, I I remember being right here and thinking there is no hope and there's no way I'm moving beyond this. There's no way I'm going to live beyond this month. And I was very much alive and I was very much living my dreams as I was now driving by the same road. And I was so grateful. Oh man, so grateful that I didn't do something so stupid and so drastic and that I get to sit here and talk about this book that hopefully, if nothing else, helps at least one person walk through the flames that I was able to get through.
Ephraim Graham, CBN News, Washington, D.C.
What an incredible story and incredible journey. And I'm glad he made it through and made it through to help others. If you had trauma in your childhood, if you had trauma any time in your life and you're wondering, what do I do? Where do I go? I encourage you to get his book. It's called Radical Love. You can find it wherever books are sold. And hopefully his journey can help you on your journey.
When Eastern Kentucky was struck by heavy rain and dangerous flooding, for many people, the water came with little warning. Brenda's an 89-year-old widow without much of an income.
It came fast. If we'd waited too much longer, we probably wouldn't have made it out. It got up on my house to here.
Operation Blessing quickly mobilized to help families in Eastern Kentucky take their first steps toward recovery. Volunteers arrived at Brenda's house, ripped up damaged floors, and tore out flood-soaked drywall.
I would like to say to the partners, thank you, thank you, thank you. God bless you.
CBN partners are changing lives. Your help brings food, water, and joy to families. Children learn, play, laugh, and smile again because you care. Partner with CBN. Please call 1-800-700-7000 or go to cbn.com.
Captain Contraband. That's how prison guard Robert Johnson was known behind bars. He and his team seized drugs, guns, knives, and cell phones that were smuggled into the prison. The job put a big target on Robert's back and a hit on his life.
It was an early morning in March 2010. Mary Johnson heard gunshots. She frantically ran through the house looking for her husband, Robert.
I kept praying, let him live, let him be alive.
She found him on the bathroom floor. He had been shot 6 times by a man who broke into their home.
I grabbed the towel and I pressed it against his chest because he was bleeding profusely.
Doctors at a nearby hospital couldn't stop the bleeding, and Robert was life-flighted to Richland Memorial Hospital in Columbia, South Carolina. When Mary arrived, Robert was in surgery, where doctors tried to repair the wounds to his chest, abdomen, liver, and lungs. A chaplain was sent to talk to Mary about Robert's condition.
He said, well, the doctor want me to let you know that he wasn't going to make it. They can't get a handle on the bleeding from the liver. So I yelled, God, I get a handle on the bleeding. And I walked off.
Moments later, the lead surgeon came out and told her the same thing. He allowed Mary to come into the operating room to say goodbye.
And the doctor took me around to his head and said, kiss him. So I grabbed his head and I kissed him. He was swollen beyond recognition. And I said, Lord, in the name of Jesus, God, let Bobby live.
When Mary left the OR, she began calling family and church friends to pray.
About 2 hours or so later, the doctor came out, the head surgeon, came out smiling, and he hugged me. And that time, I knew things had turned around. And I said, God did it. God did it. And he kept smiling.
While doctors had stopped the bleeding, they still didn't expect Robert to live much more than 2 weeks. If he did, he'd lost so much blood, he would likely have permanent brain damage.
One male nurse came back a week later. He's like, oh, he's still here? And I got upset. I'm like, what do you mean he's still here? I said, the Lord is bringing him through.
With Robert in a medically induced coma to minimize brain swelling, Mary prayed by her husband's bedside every day.
I would go over his whole body and say, Lord, let everything work and be healed in his body.
2 weeks came and went. Robert was still alive and in a coma, and Mary and a multitude of people were still praying. Week 3 would bring more bad news. Robert's heart developed AFib, where chaotic heart signals cause a rapid, erratic heartbeat. In addition, blood clots had formed in Robert's leg, and his lungs were collecting fluid. He was back in surgery again.
They told me and my sons that he could die on the table. You know, that really scared me. I said, Lord, I said, no, he's not gonna die. I said, you brought him this far. He's gonna live. I trust God. I said, I trust you, Lord, I trust you.
Again, Robert pulled through, but doctors still warned Mary that his prognosis was poor.
And he was just weak and, you know, like they thought he was gonna die. Things were going through my mind. Lord, why did this happen? Started crying, said he didn't deserve this. I said, is this working together for our good? Lord, you said in everything, give thanks. So I just started praising him. I just thanked the Lord. I said, Lord, no matter what it looks like, I give you the honor, the glory, and the praise, and I thank you.
After more than a month of surgeries, doctors had fixed everything they could. But Robert wasn't coming out of the coma. They asked Mary to try to rouse him. For days, she and her son Kenneth tried with no success, until one day.
Kenneth was on one side, I was on the other side. And I was calling him, Bobby, Bobby, wake up. He said, Daddy. His eyes popped open. We grabbed hands and he just pulled up close to us like that. And of course, tears came, you know, from us.
Robert would spend many weeks in rehab, regaining his physical strength and ability to talk.
It was a slow process, I would say. He would talk some, and then it just came back like natural. His mind was coming together more.
As Robert regained his memory, he realized there were some things doctors couldn't fix. Robert worked as a prison guard captain at Lee Correctional Institute. He and his team seized contraband, the illegal drugs, guns, knives, and cell phones smuggled inside the prison. He had made some enemies, and they wanted him dead. Ex-con Sean Eccles had been sent to do the job. Even though Eccles was convicted and sentenced to prison, Robert struggled with anger.
Because I was thinking, I said, these guys hunted me down. They tried to kill me and my wife, and bitterness was starting to build. One morning, about 3 in the morning, sounds like someone was speaking to me, and it said, forgive, because I couldn't let this root of bitterness grow up in me. It's a great freedom. Hatred and bitterness put you in bondage.
After 3 months in the hospital, Robert went home, where he continued his recovery. Although he still has pain and sometimes walks with a cane, he's grateful for every day.
I take each day as precious. It's precious time to me.
Today, he's a pastor, author, and public speaker, telling other victims of violent crime about the power of prayer and the loving God who saved his life.
Do not give up. When those doctors were ready to give up on me, my wife did not give up. She trusted God.
It's taught me that God is there. Don't ever doubt, no matter what happens. God is the only hope that anyone could ever have.
Prayer is powerful. It's not over till he says it's over.
Do not give up. Prayer is power. We believe that as well. And that's why we set aside time during our program to pray for you. We know that many of you are struggling with things that, just like Robert and Mary's situation, you know, they might look impossible. There might even be people, like some of the medical people in this scenario, that are telling you it's not going to work out. It might be financial people telling you you're never going to get out of this hole that's been dug. Listen, it can be many, many things. Maybe it's an addiction you struggle with yourself. Always, always, there is hope, and always God is there. And he is the one who has the power to touch and to change and to make a difference in your life. So we want to pray to that end with you today, joining with you, asking God to do the impossible for you in your circumstance. This is Tammy, who lives in High Point, North Carolina, Gordon. She started having significant pain in her right shoulder. She was watching this program and she heard you say someone else has a frozen shoulder, and you're saying, please say that. So I'm saying frozen shoulder is just for you. It's your right shoulder. Do what you could not do before. Lift your arm up and realize the pain is gone now. Without hesitation, Tammy claimed it. She raised her arms, and Tammy was instantly healed.
Praise God. Here's Margaret from Sarasota, Florida. She began seeing double. One day, she turned on the TV, and Terry was praying. Someone, you have an eye condition. It's something to do with the muscles of your eye not having enough tension in them, and it is affecting your vision. God is correcting that for you right now. Your eyesight will be perfect. Well, by faith, Margaret agreed with Terry. Immediately, the double vision was gone. Her sight was clear. Believe in God. That's the fundamental message. Believe in God. That's what Jesus taught in Matthew chapter 11. If you want to see miracles, have faith in God. Don't have faith in your prayer. Don't have faith in other things. Don't have faith in how much you've read the Bible or how much you haven't read the Bible. Have faith in God. Believe in Him. Believe in His power. Believe He sent Jesus. Believe that Jesus is the Messiah. Believe that by His blood, you are forgiven. You are set free from all unrighteousness. And by His stripes, you are healed. Believe that. You can rest in it. It's secure. It's set for all time, for all eternity. It's set. Jesus said, it's finished. And when He said that, He meant it. All we have to do is to walk into the finished work of the cross. When you have that faith, you leave your symptoms behind, you leave the reports behind, you leave any thought that you're righteous enough to enter into His presence. He is the one who makes you righteous. He is the one who heals you. He is your all in all. Go all in and get your healing, your need, your answer to prayer. Let's pray and do it right now. Lord, we come to You. We come to You believing, just as little children. We come to a loving Heavenly Father who wants to take care of every single need. So, Lord, we walk into the finished work of the cross. We see You. We look to You, for You are the author and the finisher of our faith. We receive all that You have for us now. In Jesus' name, amen. There's someone, you've got searing pain in your right lung with every single breath. God is healing that. You just felt that. That pain is leaving you now, and the wonderful news, it's never going to come back. You are healed, completely healed in Jesus' name. Terry?
The word that comes is entwined, and I believe this is somebody, you have a some kind of a mass in your head, and it's operable, but the problem is it's entwined with other things that make it very, very difficult. God is creating pathways to healing for you right now. Just lift up your hands and begin to receive that as He solves this dilemma that doctors can't seem to solve. Just right now, receive it. God is healing you in powerful ways.
There's someone, you're involved in an abusive relationship, and you just can't seem to get free from it, and God just wants to give you the boldness to get free. That He just wants to assure you, you don't have to take this. You can get up and leave it. And so do that right now. Just have the faith to believe that He has made a way for you. He will provide for you. He will be your all in all. He never intended this for you. He wants to set you free from it now, in Jesus' name.
Yes, someone else, you have had severe infection in your kidneys and problems with your liver as well. This is the same person. God's healing that condition for you. You've had it for a while, and it's been so frustrating. He's healing it for you now. Just feel that warmth come across your back and the side of your body as He heals you.
Someone, you scratched your cornea in your left eye, and it's very painful for you. God is able to heal that cornea. He's able to make it whole again, give you everything that you've lost, give you vision, give you everything that's been taken. In Jesus' name, be healed and be set free from it. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your wonderful power. We thank you for your wonderful love towards us. You forgive all our iniquities. You heal all our diseases. We receive everything now in Jesus' name. Amen. If you've been healed, if you've been set free, give us a call, 1-800-700-7000. If you need prayer, we're here for you. We're here for you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. All you have to do is pick up the phone and call, 1-800-700-7000. Jason was a saver. His wife, Angie, was a spender. Angie had an arsenal of 17 credit cards at her fingertips, and one day, she dug through her wallet, took out all her credit cards, and cut them all up.
I just like to spend. At the last point, I had 17 credit cards. A lot of them were department stores, jewelry stores, or American Express, Visa, those kind.
Any kind of debt stressed me out. And we had a couple of car payments at that time also. That really stressed me out. I didn't like it.
Like many couples, Jason and Angie Kabler had conflicting views about money.
When we fought about money. I think if we would have had open communication in the beginning, I think our first 7 years of marriage would not have been so hard.
Jason grew up not quite sold on tithing.
You know, if somebody asked me to share my money or to give my money for something, it was like, yeah, no, I'm not going to do that. This is my money. I want it.
However, by the time he married Angie, Jason had warmed up to the idea of tithing. While she managed the checkbook, he focused on building up his dental practice.
I was trying to figure out how to run a practice, run a business, and it was very stressful. So I gave all that over to her. But when it came down to it, it wasn't her natural inclination to want to deal with that.
The stress of handling their bills finally got to Angie.
He started just questioning me, and I got very offensive. Like, why are you questioning what I'm doing? So much to the point that one night, I threw the checkbook at him, and I told him, you will take care of it. I will no longer pay the bills. At that point, he took the lead. He became more of the head of our household.
Jason then began paying the bills. He also suggested the couple enroll in a financial strategy program through their church.
The first few sessions that she went to, she basically sat there with her arms crossed and doing this number. But as time went on, she started catching the vision a little bit, and so did I. I started learning a lot of things that I didn't know.
At the end of one of the classes, Angie surprised Jason.
The coordinator would always, at the end of the night, he would say, is there anybody that wants to cut up their credit cards tonight? Angie stood up and started digging through her billfold, took out all of those credit cards, I believe it was 17, and cut every last one of them up. And I had no idea this was going to happen.
The Kablers also took marriage counseling to help them communicate better about money.
I had to really go through a transition to learn how to let go and learn that really it all belongs to God and that it's mine to manage. And it's more of a joy now to be able to give rather than a stress. And obviously that's gotten much easier over the years.
Once we got on the same page with money and finances, that's where our marriage did a 180 and we started flourishing.
Today, the Kablers have no credit cards and no debt other than their mortgage. Jason's practice has grown as well, and he even writes a weekly blog about finances.
A blessed 90% is always greater than an unblessed 100%. It's not the kind of math we learned in school, but when you exercise that faith, he will bless that 10% and multiply it.
Be obedient with your finances and tithing and trust God. If I could encourage someone to just step out on faith and do it, try it for 90 days. Go ahead and give that 10% and trust God and watch the miracles that will take place.
Trust God and watch the miracles that will take place in your life when you just trust Him. And one of the best ways to trust Him is to trust Him with your finances. It's the only time you get to prove God. He says it very clearly in Malachi, test me now in this, prove me now in this, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven. You live life His way, wonderful things can happen. You just saw it with Jason and Angie. The first thing they had to do was get rid of the credit cards. Consumer spending is an absolute curse on you because it puts you into debt and then it gets you into interest payments, and it seems like you can never catch up. But when you live His way, say, I'm going to live within my income, I'm going to tithe 10%, I'm going to save 10%, I'm going to do it that way, wonderful things can happen. If you want to start a life of giving, give us a call, 1-800-700-7000. Just say, I want to join the 700 Club. It's $20 a month, that's 65 cents a day. Some of you are able to join at higher levels. We have 700 Club Gold at $40 a month. We also have 1,000 Club. That's $1,000 a year. That breaks out to $84 a month. At whatever level, when you call, ask for Pledge Express. That's electronic monthly giving. The bank is doing all the work, and we can send as our gift to you Power for Life monthly teaching CDs or downloads, your choice. So if you like that, ask for Pledge Express when you call or give monthly on CBN.com. There's a place on the giving page where you can give monthly. You'll automatically sign up for Pledge Express. Or you can do this new thing called Text to Give, where you can text the letter CBN to 71777. A monthly giving page will come up on your smartphone or your tablet, and you can give monthly and sign up for Pledge Express that way. Do it now. 1-800-700-7000.
The horse bucks, leaps in the air, and then jerks in the opposite direction. Bareback rodeo is a wild ride, and Anthony Thomas is one of the top champions. So at the peak of his career, why was Anthony at the lowest of lows? And how did a supernatural date totally transform him? Just watch.
Anthony Thomas has lived life much like how he rides a horse, some by saddle, some by bareback.
I was a troubled kid that ran away from home, that had a dream to be a cowboy. God definitely placed horses in my life and in my heart. I was able to connect with a horse as a young kid. I've chased wild horses all over the world. They're definitely a soulful creature that comes from God and did save my life.
The rodeo cowboy and professional bareback competitor left home in Australia at 12 years old, surviving a difficult family life.
I had a pretty traumatic childhood. My parents had me doped up pretty bad on several different types of drugs. I knew that I was troubled and confused, and I would have ended up in organized crime or in jail or dead if I had stayed there in that situation. Probably better off for me to stay away. And being with the horses and the cows and the sheep, I knew that that's what gave me a sense of belonging.
That belonging came at a ranch, a cattle station near the boarding school where he was sent. Young Anthony found stability, identifying with the unbroken horses.
I think the immediate connection that I had with those wild horses that God placed me in front of, like me, they were confused and they had used their defense mechanisms to protect themselves. And I could definitely relate to them in every way just because of the similarities in the way that we thought and the circumstances that were brought to us.
Working long hours, 7 days a week, Anthony learned the art of breaking horses.
Establishing full trust between man versus beast, the horse has got to be in the mindset that he trusts you enough to want to do that for you. You can make these big creatures do things, but they're only going to give you probably 70% of what they can do. And when you can gain that full trust and have a full sense of understanding with the horse, then you'll get close to 100% out of your horse every time.
The connection to horses provided Anthony opportunities on them. His learned instincts and neglected upbringing prepared him as a bareback rider.
They say bareback riding is taking control of a completely uncontrollable situation. You know, the horse bucks, jumps in the air, is wild, changes directions, and we just have to react and respond. And I think God prepared me to be a professional bareback rider because I need to trust the Lord and the Holy Spirit's plan 100%, surrendering to the Lord's, that it's not up to me what happens.
As a teen, Anthony looked forward to the occasional weekend rodeos in the Australian outback.
All the crews and all of the keen young cattle hands, we call them ringers, would enter the rodeos and use their skills that they would use at their job every day, like riding bucking horses and catching bulls, and showcase their talents. When I would go to those local rodeos, I ended up doing really well in all the events that I entered and got caught the rodeo buck.
In 2011, Anthony won the Australian bareback title. The following year, he moved to Canada, aiming for a North American title.
The horses are so much bigger and stronger and more athletic. The bucking horses in Canada and in the US is second to none. You know, the bright lights and the big stadiums and the huge crowds, everything was just so much different. And obviously it pushed you to be far more of a professional athlete.
Injuries and surgeries mounted, so did distractions that came with the touring territory.
You're in a different city, in a different town, and there's always a bar, there's always womanizing and partying and making bad decisions. And for probably a good 10 years of my life, I was as guilty as any man on earth, fighting and drinking and just all of the debauchery that comes with being in a party scene all the time. I remember being down in the dumps at the lowest of lows.
In 2018, Anthony worked his way up among the world's best 15 bareback riders. But his life felt meaningless. On a second date, at the request of his now wife, Amanda, they visited a church service at Hope City in Houston.
The presence of the Holy Spirit just almost knocked me off my feet. I started crying. I didn't know where it comes from. And God was just speaking to me. It was an undeniable sense of conviction, hope, and renewal, transformation of my life to become an actual kingdom man, realizing how much of a relationship that I have with Jesus, that I can talk to him as a friend, that he's always going to be there for me, he's always going to provide for me.
While the pandemic shut down rodeos, Anthony opened a farm-to-table natural beef business. The past year also brought him a new perspective with empathetic strength.
2020 really opened my eyes to some underlying racism. I think that empathy is so important. The Western industry is a predominantly white culture. It's not judgmental to anybody, it's just the way it is. Even though I am a different color to everybody else in the bareback riding sport, you would hope that the judges in the sport have everybody in their best interest, but it's not something that I can allow myself to think about. And I do believe that God's put me in rodeo, showing that people of all different colors can get along and be brothers and sisters and be family.
The rodeo bareback cowboy, ranched in Humble, Texas, embraces his story journey with humility.
Be loyal to him and show him all the glory for everything he's done for me. God has placed me in every situation, and I can't even explain how that happened. God is true and God is real, and he is a real savior, and he saved my life, and he's provided for me in every situation. Every one of us has a platform right where they are and teach them about the love of Jesus. No matter what, that there's a God that's always there for you, that has more for you than you could ever imagine.
What a message Anthony brings us. What a life he has lived. That's an amazing testimony. Well, we have a minute here for some email. So let's hear from Patricia Gordon. She says, "Hi, Gordon. When I was 13 or 14, I was saved and baptized. Throughout my adulthood, I backslid. I'm 60 now and have come to know the Lord again. Do I need to get saved and baptized again? Please help, because it really troubles my heart."
Patricia, if you want to get baptized again, please do. If married couples can reaffirm their vows and go through the ceremony again because they want to show the world we love each other, we're committed to each other, you can go through baptism again and say, I want to show the whole world that I am dead to my sins and my trespasses. I'm raised again into newness of life with Jesus Christ. And it doesn't matter what age you are. I know some denominations disagree over this, but, you know, getting rebaptized, in my view, is a wonderful thing. And if it will make you feel better, then absolutely do it. Do it as soon as you can. We leave you today with these words from Psalm 91, "For he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you in all of your ways." For Terry, for me, for all of us here, God bless you. We'll see you again.